Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Jim Cobray.
Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, giving you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. How good it is to be in the house of the Lord. We thank you, Father, that we haven't come to hear from a man. Nope, we're too smart for that. Or a woman. We haven't come to hear from a black man, a brown man, a white man, a tall man, an old man. Don't give a flip. We have come to hear from the Holy Spirit, who is the teacher of the church. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, and motivate us to be all that the Father desires us to be, all that the Son paid the price for us to be, and all that you have empowered us to be. And God will give you the praise in Jesus' mighty name. But Lord, don't just bless us. Bless all the churches in the Inland Empire, as well as around the planet, that are preaching and hearing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. There are our brothers and our sisters, and we at no time think of ourselves as better than them, but we see ourselves as co-laborers, workers together in one field, building one kingdom, not a man's, but yours, and we'll give you the praise and glory and honor. In Jesus' mighty name, with a great big shout, we all said amen. Go ahead, take your seat, get your Bible, go with me. Today, we're going to part number two of the homeland. Very important scripture today, a very important time. The title of the message is on the overhead for those of you that are taking notes. Kind of a neat little title. Let me explain it to you just a little bit so that you can understand. Strange people in a strange place. Did you know that you are strange? I want you to look at your neighbor and say, don't do that. You are strange people in a strange place. In fact, the world looks at you like you're crazy. And you are very peculiar. You know, you're kind of weird, in fact, if you want to know something. And you're a strange person in a strange place. And what that really means is that you and I have got to understand how important it is for us to realize the Bible says a lot about how we should be thinking about ourselves and how we think about ourselves daily, every single day. And it's important that we see that the Bible says that your time here on earth is but vapor time. Now, if I had an aerosol can, and if I was standing in front of you when the Bible made it clear that your time here on earth is but a vapor, and James, it says that, I would squirt that aerosol can, and you would see a little vapor go out, and in a few seconds, it would evaporate, and it would be gone. And God makes this statement about you and about me, that our time here on earth is but a vapor. It goes out, it's seen for a moment, and then it's gone. I was puzzled by that for years until God spoke to me and said, in comparison to eternity, your time here on earth is but a vapor. It's just a moment, but eternity is forever and ever and ever and ever. And sometimes, in fact, most of the time, we that call ourselves Christians get tied up in the cares of this world so much that it bogs us down and keeps us from fulfilling and doing and being what God called us to do and feel and be. We get carrying all the time the weight of the economy, of our own personal economy. We get carried with schoolwork and job work and businesses that we have. We get bogged down with our children from time to time, and we just, our houses and our situations and our cars and our finances, and got a flat tire, ran out of gas, not knowing how I'm going to make it, how am I going to make my bills, and in this vapor time, we get so caught up, but really the truth is, we're just passing through. I've got news for you. Listen to what I'm going to say to you. You were born naked, and when you leave this place, you'll take nothing with you. Isn't that a peculiar thing? Except that you have an eternal existence somewhere. And we want to enhance that today. Instead of carrying the weights of the world, instead of carrying the problems of every day, you know what politicians say and what's happening in the Mideast and what the news media tells you and all the crazy things that go on, the weight of economics, the weight of your, you know, problems that are at you, the bill that you got in the mail or the statement you got from some organization that says you've done wrong and you're concerned and worried about those things. Can I give you good news? Today, you're a stranger in a strange place. In fact, it is this. You are just passing through. And if you will keep that in mind every single day, then the weight of the world will never stick to you and bog you down so you can't do what God would have you to do. We're so weighted down with things, with this world, and opportunities the world presents to us, and ideas and philosophies and ideologies of this world that we forget about who we are. We are a stranger in a strange place. In other words, the Bible says that you're in this world, but you're not of it. You're in this world, but you're not of it. One more time. You're in this world, but you're not of it. And may I tell you, that in itself is good news. Now I'm going to take you to Hebrews in the 11th chapter, and we're going to start reading the Word of God together. Hebrews, the 11th chapter, if you'll go there with me, let's take a look at starting with verse number 13. He talks about these saints that we've been talking about, you know, Abraham and Sarah and all the others that have gone before that the Word of God's talking about. And they have become an example for us to learn today how to deal with life, how you deal with your marriage, how you deal with your children, how you deal with your finances, how you deal with your business, how you deal with your future. And without the right attitude, without the right thinking, you're going to deal with it the wrong way, and it's going to rob your ability to get the job done that God wants you to do. So let's read this together. Is that okay? Now, I want you to concentrate with me for a few minutes. We'll let you go in a little bit, but we're going to concentrate and learn something from God's Word. Is that all right? In Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse 13 says, "These all died in faith," speaking of the saints that we've been studying. "They all died in faith, not having received the promise, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them." I love this. Remember Pastor Dan talked about that? They were assured of them, embraced them, remember that? And confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on this earth. In other words, everybody, you got to get this. Now, I'm not going to let you fall asleep on me. Everybody that you're going to see in the scripture had a mentality about something that made them successful, that helped them get through. They knew they were just passing through. They confessed, look at the word up there, that they were strangers and pilgrims on this earth. They didn't see themselves as one stuck in this earth. They didn't see this one who's relying on this earth. They didn't see themselves that the world that they're living in was their future. No, they saw themselves as pilgrims and strangers. In other words, they're just people who are passing through. We're not here to hold on to stuff we can't keep. There's something waiting better for us. And guess what? That in itself is good news. But then it goes on in verse number 14, talking about them again. Now watch this. Now remember, I'm saying all of this so that you can get a hold of it, so you can be a stronger Christian, fulfilling with joy the things that God has set before you. Now watch this. "For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland." In other words, listen, my home is not this earth. I may have a nice home. I may have a nice car. And God wants you to have that. God wants to bless you. Don't misunderstand me at all. But you can't get so attached to this vapor time on this earth that you forget about who you really are. You're just a stranger and a pilgrim passing through, looking for the homeland that God has made for you. Come on, somebody. And in verse number 15, it says this in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse number 15, it says, "And truly, if they called to mind." Now, this is kind of a really weird little verse. Truly, let me make you think for a moment. If they called to mind. Now, you've got to get this. Don't let it just pass. Don't let yourself daydream. Truly, talking about those that talked about being strangers and pilgrims in the land, that they confessed it. Truly, they were looking for a homeland, but they said, truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out of, they would have had opportunity to return. In other words, if their mind was set on what they had here on the planet in the past, then they would have been back to the past. They would have stayed in the, tied up in this instead. Their minds were fixed on the fact and the truth that they were pilgrims and strangers. That's what they confessed. Man, we're here, but we're really not here. We're here, we're in this world, but we're really not of this world. We're really not here at all because we're with Christ Jesus. But my vapor time, I'm going to live for the glory of God because I'm not taking anything from this world with me. And with that attitude, they became great saints. And you and I, every day of our life, are so tied up in our businesses and our houses and our money and our finances and politicians and what we personally have or don't have right now that we lose track of who we really are. We are sojourners in this land, pilgrims, strangers in a strange land. He says, but and if their thinking wasn't that way, they would have gone back to the old ways. Did you know that's exactly the same with you? If your thinking is not the way they're talking about, you'll go back to where you used to be and live in the world instead of living for God. Are you listening to what I'm saying to you? It's so important for us to get a picture of this. Verse number, I'm going to keep that in mind, by the way, how they had an opportunity to go back because it was something they could have had in their mind, but they kept it in the forefront of their mind in verse number 15. Verse number 16 says this, but now they desire a better, that is a heavenly country. That's where their mind was fixed on. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. I mean, what made them special to God is that they were looking for the things God could bring them, not for the things they had here on this planet. Now, don't misunderstand me. It's not that God doesn't want to bless you in your vapor time. It's not that God doesn't want to give you a great house, give you a great business, give you a great car, give you to be a witness to a lost and dying world. He wants to prosper you. I saw, when I was a young man, I saw a car go down the street, had Jesus bumper and stickers all over, smoke pouring out of the back. Someone broke out the back window. It was dented up. I could hardly wait to follow that guy. Not a chance. Didn't want any part of it. God doesn't want you busted, disgusted, down and out, trying to be a witness. Nobody wants to follow you. God wants to prosper you and successful, but you can't get so prosperous or successful. That becomes your emphasis in your vapor time. What the emphasis is in your vapor time is that you are a strange people in a strange place. Somebody ought to give me a great big amen on that. It's just true. Now, what we don't see and what we don't know oftentimes is that Jesus, this is so interesting, Jesus sees you that way. And a lot of times we don't see that. Jesus sees you as a pilgrim. Jesus sees you as a stranger. When Jesus talks about those that are saved, he talks about them are people who have this kind of a mentality about who they are. Did you know that he assumes that if you're really saved, you have that kind of, I'm here as a pilgrim, a stranger in a strange place. I'm in the world, but I'm not of the world. Did you know that Jesus sees that in you? And when he looks at you, he says that. But yet most of us don't act that way at all. Go with me, if you will. This is kind of fun. In John, the 17th chapter, let's take a look at the words of Jesus in John, the 17th chapter. Can I just say this to you? Somehow, when Jesus speaks, there's a little more of an emphasis. I like it a little better. You know what I'm talking about? I like the red letter words of Jesus. He's talking to the Father in a prayer about you. Now, wait a minute. Let me say that again. He's talking to the Father in a prayer about you. Some of you say, oh no, oh my, that's kind of scary. Don't be scared. He sees you a certain way. Oftentimes what he sees is not what we see. And it's what we see that's going to determine where we go. and what we do. And so he's talking to the Father. Remember I said he sees you as a pilgrim. He sees you as somebody who's in the world but not of the world. Listen to what he says to the Father, verse 14. In verse number 14, he says it like this. I have given them your word. What blew me away about this, he could have said to the Father, I have given them my word. But do you remember how precise the word of God is? This is just a footnote, just a thought. Jesus said to the Father, I have given them your word. Jesus made a statement, the words that I speak that are not mine, but he that sent me. When you see me, you see the Father. Therefore, if he had said, I had given them my word, it wouldn't have been the word from the Father that he stated. Oh my goodness, how precise is the word of God? And he makes this statement, I have given them your word. And the world has hated the world. You got to get this. The world has hated them. The world hates them. You don't know that yet, that Christians are hated all over the world? There are thousands being persecuted every single day and thousands and tens of thousands being murdered. They're cutting the heads off of Christians in some countries right now. You got to be kidding me. There's an idiot on the campus of a small school in Oregon 2 days ago who shot and killed, guess who? Christians. The news media didn't carry it. Did you know that CNN didn't carry it? Did you know that the Los Angeles Times didn't carry it? That was a persecution against Christians. Did you know that the New York Times did not carry that it was a persecution against Christians? They would have said something if it was some other organization, but against Christians, they didn't say one word about it. The only one that carried it, and I might as well tell you, was Fox News. I'm not preaching Fox News today. I'm just telling you, somebody's going to tell the truth and somebody isn't. And so listen to this. What I'm trying to say to you is this. The people will hate you. Why? Because they are not of the world. You got to be and see yourself as a stranger in a strange place. If you don't see yourself as a stranger in a strange place, then you will live for today and in this place by what you get instead of who he is. You know, sometimes we Christians are like a duck out of water looking for a pond. We're looking everywhere when in fact Jesus is the pond and he's right in front of us. Come on, somebody. He says these, just as I am not in the world, verse number 15 comes along and it's an amazing verse. He says, I do not pray that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil one. Every one of us need to understand that God, don't you know Jesus gets answers to his prayer? I mean, he's going to talk to the Father. Can I tell you something? The Father's not going to say, well, who's talking? I don't know that. What? I'm too busy for you, Jesus. And that's not going to happen. Jesus is making intercession for you. Why? Not that you get out of this world, but that you stay. But the evil one, listen to this, doesn't going to touch you, keep you from the evil one. When your family, your children, you wonder how you're going to make it, you got to understand something. There's a hedge of protection about you. Don't allow anything in there. Jesus is standing in the gap for you. And verse number 16 comes along. Listen to verse 16. They are, again, same thing. They're not of the world, just as I'm not of the world. We ought to be just like Jesus. I'm gonna try it again. You didn't listen. We ought to be just like Jesus. No, wait a minute, that's like 25% of you. I gotta get the rest of you involved. We ought to be like Jesus. That's like 50% of you. Oh, wait a minute, it's not gonna work. It's not gonna work. I'm not letting 50% of you get away. We ought to be like Jesus. Is that not true? And Jesus is not of this world. And we're not of this world. What in the world are we doing every day putting our pressure on ourselves because we're dealing with our vapor time the wrong way? Hey, listen, can I tell you something? Pastor Jim is just passing through. I know some of you don't like me, can hardly wait for me to pass through. That's okay, but guess what? I could give a flip because I'm going to pass through whether you like me or don't like me. Glory to God. Are you hearing me? So Jesus sees you that way. His anticipation is you are that way. His assumption is you're that way. Isn't that interesting? A stranger and a pilgrim in a strange place. Now, if I'm going to do something. I'm going to pick the right homeland. How do I pick that homeland? How do I stay in there? How do I get this done? So how do I, let me give you four little things. Can I just say, share this with you? I could give you 40 things. One woman on the front row said, all right. She's willing to sit here and listen to me give 40 things. She's the only woman in the world. Let's make her an elder in the whole place. The rest of you are saying, oh my goodness sakes, I'm 40? You gotta be kidding. I'm not sitting here that long. I got lunch in a few minutes and I'm getting hungry. My stomach's starting to growl even as it is. Hurry up, preacher. I have four things for you in order for you to pick and how to pick the right homeland so you stay on the right page and you don't get caught up in the things of the world and the lusts of this world. Here's number one. Stop it. Abstain. You say, wait a minute. Stop what? Abstain from what? What am I supposed to? I'm glad. Hold on to that question. I'm going to answer it in just a moment. But I want you to go with me to 2 Peter. Will you do that? In 1 Peter. This gets a little confusing. 1 Peter, the second chapter. 1 Peter, the second chapter. Because I want to read you out of 1 Peter, the second chapter, starting in verse number 9. In verse number 10, are just something I want to give to you. It's not going to answer your question. In verse number 11 is going to answer your question, what am I abstaining, stopping from? Are you following me? But I want to take a little sidestep right here, so don't get confused. And let's go to verse number 9. God says four things about you. Now, wait a minute. You say, wait a minute. Peter wrote this. Yes, but Peter's under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. All of it's the inspiration. Therefore, it's not Peter, it's the Holy Spirit under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So God is saying this about you, four things you've got to know. And I love the first part of it. Verse number 9, he says this, but you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. A holy nation, his own special people. Can I just say something? Let me add a few other things that you think about yourself. I'm a dirt ball. I'm stupid. I can never accomplish anything. I've made bad decisions. I tell you what, I make one bad decision after another bad decision. God could never trust me. I could never. Does it say any of that up there? No. So let's look at it for a second. It says, but you are, not that you're, here's what God did and paid for this price with his blood on the cross when you became a Christian. God says you are a chosen generation. Let me tell you something. God chose you. When he went to that cross, he saw your face and saw my face. And God, listen, you may think of yourself as nothing, but God chose you. You may say to yourself, wait a minute, you don't understand. I'm not even on this earth legally. My mom and dad were two drunk people in the back of a car, came out of a nightclub one night, had a one-night stand. I was born and my mother was a drug addict and a dope dealer, and she gave me away. But I'm here to tell you something different. I don't care how you got in this planet, Jesus is your Savior, and he makes you a holy nation. In other words, listen to this. He has just leveled the playing field. Has nothing to do with your education. Has nothing to do with the color of your skin. Has nothing to do with how smart you are. Has nothing to do with who you know. Has nothing to do with how much money you have. Has nothing to do with your job. He just leveled the playing field. Now, I just got real Pentecostal with you. Didn't I? But how do I say it any other way? What would you like me to do? Jesus has leveled the playing field for you. That doesn't do it, does it? I mean, you stop and think about it. Oh my goodness sakes. You know, you're a chosen generation. I hope you are. Come on. I had to shake myself up here. Sometimes I don't feel like a chosen generation. Huh? You don't either, but we are. And you got to start seeing yourself that way. You're a royal priesthood. Did you know there's never been a royal priesthood? That means kings and priests. You know what a king is over? A king's over the fleshly thing. Priests are over the spiritual thing. Did you know that Melchizedek and Jesus were the only two until the body of Christ comes along? And now the Bible says in Book of Revelation that you that are born of the Spirit of God are a royal priest. You are kings and priests. Third thing he says about you is that you are a holy nation. You know what that means? Listen, I don't care what tribe you came out of. We have a new tribe called the tribe of Judah. That if you're born of the Spirit of God, we're all there. And if you're born of the Spirit of God, now we are set apart to God, or we are exclusively God's. And we're an entire nation that is a holy nation. Come on, somebody. It's true. And I love this part. I haven't even gotten to answer that question yet, so don't forget about that. I'll remind you of it in a minute. His own special people. See the word special up there means peculiar. You know what that means? It means you are weird. In fact, the old King James uses the word peculiar. You know, Christians are peculiar to the world. They can't figure us out. They'll try to kill us. We're like a great old Persian carpet. The more you step on it, the more wealth it becomes. You know, go ahead, put pressure on us. We'll just keep telling people about Jesus and get stronger and stronger. You're not getting rid of us. Because why? He says, you are his own special people. And what for? That you may proclaim the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Isn't that fabulous? Verse number 10 says these words, watch this. Who once were not a people, but now are a people of God. Who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Someone say praise the Lord on that verse. Don't we need mercy? Come on, you can do that old Pentecostal. Give me that wave right now. Everybody wave up here and say, ooh, glory to God. Oh, a bunch of Pentecostals. I'm going to some other church. And verse number 11, watch verse 11. Here's the cool verse. Beloved, I beg you. Remember, this is the inspiration of God. When God says, I beg you, okay, you don't understand the impact of those words. That's not Paul begging you. That's the Holy Spirit begging you. Get a picture of this. You wake up in the morning. You come down out of your bed. Oh, I gotta get that coffee. You're walking through the living room. Listen, even I walked like that when I was young. And you're walking through the living room. And all of a sudden in the living room, oh my goodness, there's someone in the chair. And you say, but somehow you just know. Oh my goodness, your flesh starts to crawl and the hair stands up on the edges of your arms, and all of a sudden the tears start to flood your eyes, and he says, I'm God, your creator, and I want to talk to you, and I want to beg you to do something. Every single one of us in here would say, God, hold on, I got to get my coffee first. Not one of us. We would drop to our knees and we would say, God, you don't have to beg me. Just ask me what you want. You don't have to beg me. Is it that important that you would beg me to do something? That's why that verse says it. I beg you. As what? Sojourners, pilgrims, what am I to stop? What am I to abstain from? That was the question, remember? If I'm going to pick the right homeland, I've got to stop something in my life. I've got to abstain from something. Fleshly lusts which war against the soul. In other words, it's those things that are contrary to the ways of God that keep you in bondage instead of letting you free. It's when you get tied up in the ways of the world instead of getting tied up in the things of God. But if you are a sojourner, I'm just passing through, that stuff can't stick on me. I can have it, I can enjoy it, but it's not gonna stick on me, nor is it my passion. Someone said to me, you know, I like to sail. I have a little sailboat. Debbie and I go sailing every now and then, just kind of me and Mama. And I like that because I got her on the sailboat. She can't run from me. When I catch her, I don't know what to do anymore. I forgot. Well, my kids are going, shut up. When you get my age, you'll find out. And so someone came up to me and said to me one day, oh, is sailing your passion? No, sailing's not my passion. I was so hurt they said that. After all my life of serving God, when you met God, there's nothing else but God. There's no stupid boat, stupid car, stupid houses. Those things are non-essential. They may be fun to play with, but they are stupid. When you've met God, you have nothing on this earth is at all important. And that's what he's saying, that you don't let those things come in, those vapor time fleshly desires that are contrary to the ways of God rule your thinking. Whew, so important for us. Remember I told you four things. Number one is stop and abstain from fleshly lusts. And you could do it, God wouldn't tell you to do. If you couldn't do it, you can do it. Number two, I love this. If I'm gonna stop, then I'm gonna have to renew my thinking. Because this is all about, remember verse 15 of the 11th chapter of Hebrews? Because they had it in their mind. If they had had it in their mind, they would have had opportunity to go back to it. But they didn't have it in their mind. What they did is they confessed that they were just passing through. I've got to renew my thinking. I can't think like I used to think and things that motivated me. My motivation, my thinking now is going to be changed by the things of God instead of my flesh that ruled me. And you gotta come to a place in your walk with Jesus. Every one of us that are in here, hear me now, hear me, hear me. You're gonna have to make a decision. Who's the boss of your life? Your flesh or your God? And you're gonna have to come to that place as to who's the boss. And I've got to change my thinking. I can no longer think that way. And I love the word of God in Romans. If you'll go there with me in the 12th chapter. It's a familiar verse, but for some of you, it's brand new. Verse number one, it says, I beseech you, brethren. Therefore, the word beseech, you know what it means? Same thing. I beg you. So here's God begging us to do something else. Can you imagine that? I beg you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies as living sacrifices, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. This is not a big deal. This is what you should be doing. That's what he just said. And he makes this statement as a living sacrifice. In other words, I could offer my body up and get enough nerve up to die. But do I have enough nerve to live dead all my life to the things of this world? That's a living sacrifice. He's not asking me to die once. He's asking me to die every day to the things of this world. So that if you're not there, this is how you get there. This is how you do this. You've got to change your thinking. Listen to what it says in the very next verse. In verse number two, it says it like this. And do not be conformed to this world. And isn't that the world trying to conform you? Every politician that's out there talking, what a bunch of junk. Have we not heard it? Have you not been around long enough? Everybody says the right things until they get in office. Are you knowing what I'm talking about? It's like, come on, guys. How stupid do you think we are? We must be pretty stupid because we're sure lining up with some pretty crazy people. Not me. I'm just passing through. It says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. God wouldn't tell you to renew your mind if you couldn't do it. You can. Same with your children. You ought to start working on renewing their minds right away to break off of the things that are in their DNA that would try to keep them from being what God's called them to do. You might as well start right away. Renew their minds that you may prove what is the good and acceptable, perfect will of God. So the first thing is stop those lustly, fleshly things, ideas that are in the world. Second, you do it by renewing your mind to the things of God and not let yourself be conformed to this world. But the third thing is kind of fun. You're going to have to do this. And this is how you select and pick that homeland the right way, is you're going to have to be somebody, my friends, that cast down. You're going to have to learn how to cast down every thought that comes in that is contrary to the ways of God. Every thought that comes in that's contrary to what God says about you. God says you're blessed. God says you're His. God says you're healed. God says He wants to prosper you. God says He wants to go before you. God wants to wash you clean in every area of your life. God wants to set you free from every bondage in your life. Guess what? What God says is what's been, but my mind says something different constantly. I'm not talking about some stupid psycho-cybernetics, think and grow rich, putrid stuff. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the Bible that tells us exactly that every day when something comes in that's contrary to the ways of God, I'm not to think about it, I'm to cast it down. Now, wait a minute. Before you applaud, let me tell you something. The Bible says, watch this, watch this, watch this, watch this, watch this. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. That's what the Bible says. Let me try it again. As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. The book of James says it like this. Listen to this. Lust entertain births sin. Sin births death. I don't want death. Then don't entertain lust. How do I entertain lust? Thinking. When I think about something, it isn't very long before I'm into that something. You don't ever do anything until you think about it. And sometimes you're thinking, I don't want to, I don't want to, I don't want to. Paul writes it like this. How come the things that I want to do, I don't do? How come what I don't want to do, that's what I end up doing? Oh my goodness, who will deliver me from this? Guess what? His next verse comes along, verse 27, says Jesus Christ. What you start to think, you got to cast down. If you meditate it, oh, listen to this. It'll bring birth to sin. Sin will bring birth to your death. And a lot of times we don't understand the very principle that is outlined in the Word of God that helps us to be all that God's paid for us to be on that cross at Calvary. You say, I like it better when someone just prays for me and all of a sudden I'm perfect. Can I tell you something? Can you show me somebody that did that? Oh, just lay hands on me and I don't have to do anything. Just pray for me that I get delivered. Guess what? It doesn't say anything at all. He says, keep yourself and the wicked one will touch you. You're going to have to do this yourself. He's already gone to the cross and died for you, gave you the power of the Holy Spirit. Come on, now there's greater He that's in you than he that's in the world. And you're asking me, He's got to do more? You're going to have to get in line with what He tells you to do and do it. Yeah. Is anybody listening? And in 2 Corinthians, go there with me, the 10th chapter of 2 Corinthians, verse 5 says, cast down arguments and every high thing. That does what? Exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Clear as a bell. It says cast down arguments. Anybody ever argued with your flesh? I want it. I want it. I really want it. I gotta have it. I want it. I want it. I want it. I'm just gonna, I just one piece of that pie. I don't care if I've had 16 others. I want another one. And you argue all the time, I shouldn't, I shouldn't, I should. You're always doing that. Guess what? It's arguing in the flesh. He says, cast down arguments. In other words, get rid of them. Don't think about them. Because if you think about them, it'll breed lust. And lust will breed sin. And sin brings death. Cast down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against what God says about you. Watch this. Bring it into every thought. Bring in every what? I've worked really hard. I have veins sticking out of my neck up here. I'm really old. I'm starting to perspire. And I ask a question and two people on the front row respond, God, this is really like tough on me right now. Let's try it again. You want me to try it again? Okay, I'll try it again. Bring it into what? Every what? Thought. All of a sudden, what you think is what you're going to become. If you think of yourself as a no good loser, trust me, you will be a no good loser. A failure, you'll be a failure. But if you see yourself as a holy nation, a royal priesthood, listen to this, a chosen generations, oh yeah, peculiar to him as a special people, all of a sudden, you cast down those imaginations. Listen to this. And bring into captivity those thoughts to the obedience of Christ. In other words, you got to know to put the word in its place. Not just, I don't want to do it. Is everybody listening? We can get into that at a later time. I quit. Last one I've got to share with you, and I'll do it quickly. I gave you four. Number one. Stop it. Abstain. Number two, renew. Number three, cast. Number four, walk. Walk like Jesus. Nowhere in the Bible does God trick you. He tells you to do something, you can do it. I love this word. Let's just go on up in 2 John because we're out of time. In 2 John, would you go with me? Let's go to verse number 6. Is that okay? In verse number 6, it says, he who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just like him. In other words, walk just as he walked. Did you know the Bible tells us as Jesus is on this earth, he's called you to be? You carry the heart, you carry the hands, you carry the shoulders, you carry the mouth, you carry the encouragement, you carry the spirit. You're nothing. Did you know the word Christian means little Christ? Isn't that an interesting thing? And you need to walk. Now that you know that you can stop from the lusts and realize that you're just passing through. Now that you know that you can renew your mind to the things of God which are found in the Word of God. Now that you know that you can do something like casting down those thoughts that come in and bringing every thought into obedience to the Word of God. Now that you know that the plan of God is that you walk like Jesus upon this planet, there's a lost and dying world ready to hear about Jesus and you're his mouthpiece. Now, wait a minute. If you receive something from God today, give him a great big praise. We do that? Hallelujah. Woo! Isn't that good? Okay, now, all of you that stayed, God bless you. Thank you for doing that. I want to talk to you just for a moment. In fact, here's what I want to say to you. Somebody needs to love you enough, respect you, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. You don't need somebody come along, blowing smoke all over you and all that stuff. What you need is somebody to tell you the truth about Jesus. And listen to what I'm going to say to you. You can't get in heaven any other way but his way. The one who went to the cross and died for you so that you can have eternal life. You can have that. Died for you, and he doesn't leave it up to you how you get to heaven. He doesn't leave it up to me and how I get to heaven. He's not saying do what some well-meaning church committee says. How you get to heaven is his way. And Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. Now listen to the rest of the verse. He says, and no man goes to the Father except by me. You're not going to make it any other way except Jesus. And he tells us the way, how to get there in the Word of God, John 3rd chapter. Some of you think you're going to make it to heaven because you're really good. Nowhere in the Bible does it say because you're good, you get to go to heaven. It's not in the Bible. You're not going to make it. Some of you think you're going to get to heaven because your mom and dad told you you're a Christian. And you've always thought of yourself as a Christian. You're not some other religion. So if anybody asked you, you'd say you were a Christian. But can I tell you something? Nowhere in the Bible does it say because you call yourself a Christian makes you a Christian. It's not in the Bible and you're not going to make it. And that's going to be too late when you find that out unless somebody tells you the truth. Some of you think if you hope enough, like I hope I make it. If you ask me if I was going to make it, I hope I make it. Guess what? Nowhere in the Bible says you can hope your way into heaven. You're not going to make it. And somebody needs to tell you. You're going to live somewhere. Listen to this. Listen. You're going to live somewhere for eternity. Yep. There's only two things that last forever. The soul of man and the word of God. And you're going to live somewhere for eternity. It'll either be in hell or it'll be in heaven. And that call is yours. You might say to yourself, well, Pastor, how do I make the right call? Let's do it God's way. Jesus said these words, and here's how you get to heaven. You must be born again. When I use the word born again, everybody like freaks out in America because they don't like the word born again, but it's still the truth. Jesus said it. Here's what it means. I don't care what Hollywood describes born again people like, or television describes born again people like. Hollywood and television don't determine what's born again. Jesus does. Here's what God is after from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible. Here's what he's after. All of your heart, and all of your life. You see, it's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Always has been, always will be. All or nothing. You know, there's people out there that'll tickle your ears because they want you to come to their church and give your money. But I'm here to tell you exactly the way it really is. It's an all or nothing relationship, and somebody needs to love you enough to tell you the truth. This is not a game with God. And the only way you can do this, give him all of your heart and give him all of your life, is you've got to make the commitment yourself to do that, giving him all of your heart and all of your life. Listen to this. I'll prove it to you. It's all or nothing. Last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking. He says, I'm coming again. And when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold. Because if I find, Jesus said this, watch this. If I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. You know what he just said? People that are lukewarm are going to get vomited from the mouth of Jesus. They're not going to make it. What's a lukewarm person? It's somebody who calls himself a Christian, but he's really just lukewarm. And he's not going to make it. Now, what's lukewarm? Let me define it for you. It's a little in, little out, little up, little down, token prayer, occasional church attendance. You know, you're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. God is just something in your life. He's not everything in your life. Can I tell you something? God will never settle for just something in your life and not everything. He's got all of heaven waiting for you. You think it's just for somebody who has a casual relationship with Jesus? Someone said, wait a minute, Pastor, I know who Jesus is. Does that make me a Christian? Huh, the devil knows who Jesus is. He's not a Christian. It's not what you have in your head. And I don't care how many times you celebrate Christmas and Easter. Every one of us do that. That doesn't make you a Christian. It's what you've done with your heart. Have you given him all of your heart, given him all of your life? I emphasize the word give because he won't steal it from you. He's not a thief or a conniver. He won't talk you out of it. It's your call, your choice to give him all of your heart and all of your life. Now, you can go to churches that don't bother you about this at all. But I'm telling you something right now. The devil wants to put pressure on you not to give it to him. I'm putting pressure on you to give to him. And today is your day of salvation. This is a divine appointment. God brought you here for a reason. And today, the reason is this, that you give him all of your heart, give him all of your life, be born again, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. Today is your day. In a moment, you say, Pastor Jim, how do I do this? Well, in a moment, I'll count to three. Let's do it God's way. Jesus said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. But if you deny me, I'll deny you. In a moment, I'll count to three. I'll go one, two, three, and I'll pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear that sound, bang! Your hand goes up. I'll see your hand go up. You can put it right back down. What you're saying by the raising of your hand is, I don't want to go to hell. I want to go to heaven. I want to give God all my heart, give God all my life. It's as simple as that. You say, wait a minute, Pastor, you want me to raise my hand? If I raise my hand, I'll feel funny. I'll be embarrassed. The people I came with, they'll see me. The people behind me will see me. I'll feel weird. Yep, you will. Get over it. It's better to feel weird in a safe place like this than to be in hell forever and ever because you care more about what people think instead of what God sees. Come on, no one's that dumb, but the devil's trying to talk you out of getting your hand up right now, and you know you need to get your hand up. All across this auditorium, I've done my job. Who should raise their hand if you've been running from God instead of to God? If you've never given him all of your heart, I'm speaking to you. Never given him all of your life, I'm speaking to you. If you're not sure, make sure today is your day of salvation. All across this auditorium, back in the family room, all across the top, all over the place. This is it, even in the foyer or down by the Love Rock Cafe. If you hear my voice right now, get ready to put your hand up before God. Today is your day of salvation. I want to see you do that. So does God. Are you serious about God enough to raise your hand? Simple as that. Make a public statement that you're giving God all of your heart. If you've never done it, today is your day of salvation. I'm counting to three. I've done my job. One. Two, three, let me see your hands, let me see your hands. There's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10. Thank you, back here, 11, thank you, 12, 13, thank you, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, thank you, back here, 21, back over on this side, 22, God bless you, 23, back over here. Anybody else? There's another one back there, 24, thank you, another two back here, 24, 25, thank you. I think I already got them, but I'll count them anyway because I love numbers. 25, anybody else? Anybody else? Anybody else? If you're sitting there saying to yourself, I wonder if I should, in the foyer, is anybody raising their hand in the foyer? How many? Three in the foyer. Thank God. Let's see, that's 20. I'm not very smart, I'm just saved. 25, 26, 27. Oh, glory to God. 27. I think there's 30. I could just feel 30. Come on, I'm not selling knives at the county fair, but I could do that, you know. Anybody else? Anybody else that didn't get your hand up, but you know you should have? Anybody else? Anybody else? Well, let's give the Lord. Oh, there's, wait a minute, no. There's another one, 28. Where's 29? 29. Where are you? You're saying to yourself right now, I wish that big mouth old man would just shut up. I'm not shutting up. You're going to thank me someday when you stand before the Lord. He'll say, well done, good and faithful. Where are you, 29? Let's give the Lord a hand for 28. God bless you. All 28 of you, here's what I want you to do. You're serious about God and you raised your hand, all 28 of you. I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, friend. Get your stuff. If you got a friend with you, bring them. That's okay if you want to. You don't have to, but you can bring your friend. If you're sitting next to somebody that didn't raise their hand, go ahead and ask them, come on, I'll go with you. If you want to go, I'll go with you, and you can get right. So even if you didn't raise your hand, you can come too and get saved. Today is your day of salvation. Let's all stand, welcome the people as they come. You come right now. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
You're all my life. You're all I need. So take all these pieces.
Oh, they're coming. Give them a hand as they come.
Take a look down inside. See what you see. Know that I love you from the deepest part of me.
Oh, they're still coming. They're still coming. Give them a hand as they come. Wow. Give them a hand as they come. Wow, look at this. Come on. Come on home. Come on, you get right with God today.
See what you see. Know that I love you.
Come on, it's not too late. Come on. Come on, if you need to. Come, 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 come. Just bring your baby. Come on. They're still coming.
You're all I need. So take all these pieces and then add to keep.
Isn't God good? It's so cool. Put a smile on your face because this is a good thing. It's not a bad thing. You know, it's not like you're going to die and go to hell. You're going to go to heaven. This is a good, this is a happy day. In fact, Debbie says it like this. Your angels have been waiting for you. There's guardian angels, the Bible says, and they've been waiting for you. You know, they're taking care of you. And it says when you get saved, they go into a party mode, man. They're in heaven right now. They're all rocking out and because you're going to get right with God. So put a smile on your face. It's great. Over here, see this guy waving at you. His name is Pastor Joel, like Noel, Joel. He's a good guy. No weird stuff goes on. He's going to do three things. Pray with you, give you some free information, introduce you to a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers that you'll meet before church service, help you to get strong, pray for you and your future and your family, pray for your existence. I'm telling you, if you'll hang around this place for 1 year, if you'll hang around this place for 1 year, tell me if I'm lying. 1 year, if you'll give God 1 year, just 1 year, God will bless you like you can't imagine. And it's true. It's true. But today, instantaneously, you're going to get saved today, headed for heaven, and denying your presence in hell. Hallelujah. That's the best news all day. Make a left turn. Follow Joel right over there. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.